Okay, this sermon is entitled Real Grace versus False Grace. I'd like to open up with prayer and then with a few verses. All right, dear God, thank you for giving us your clear word. Thank you for allowing us to see what it says. Bless the listeners. I ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Psalm 54 reads, Save me, O God, by thy name, and judge me by thy strength. Hear my prayer, O God. Give ear to the words of my mouth, for strangers are risen up against me, and oppressors seek after my soul. They have not set God before them, Selah. Now, the Bible teaches that salvation is by grace. We see this concept in the Old Testament. It says, you know, that Noah found grace in the eyes of God. We see the concept of grace in the book of Exodus, where it talks about, like, God carrying people on like, the wings of an eagle. And it says he carried them to himself. And we need to understand what true grace is. True grace is what totally saves. It's what totally covers all sins. And true grace is infinite, and it covers any sin imaginable. Now, false grace is the type of grace that doesn't really save anyone, and of course it doesn't save anyone, but the way people teach it, it wouldn't save anyone either, the way it's being taught. Because here's what false grace is. False grace is something that's going to improve you, or something that will not permit, you know, horrible sins. And this is not grace at all. Okay, the Bible does not teach anything like this. The Bible says, For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. The Bible excludes any human effort or merit. And in fact, grace should teach us to live for God, and it will if you read the Bible and start growing in grace. But grace does not have to teach anyone to serve God. Grace is not going to guarantee that anyone will serve God, and grace is not going to improve a person one bit. Okay? But if you grow in grace, then you start to, you know, spiritually mature. But that's another issue. That's not a salvation issue. The issue here is salvation. The Bible talks about what the real grace of God is in 1 Peter chapter 5. And I'm getting sick of all these stupid, unsaved false prophets out there who want to sit there and say, we're saved by grace, but... No, you don't add anything to we're saved by grace. We're saved by grace, period. Okay? And I'm sick of this junk, and people need to start discerning, you know, who the real preachers are, preachers of God are. And you can tell who they are if they're preaching an unalloyed, unmixed message of grace. You don't mix anything with God's grace. See, the unsaved false prophets out there, they think that there's got to be some type of a balance. You have to harmonize works with grace. No, if you harmonize works with grace, you cancel grace. Okay, Romans 11:6 says it's either all of grace or it's all works. So if you want to add any type of works or any type of qualifications or say that, well, a person will serve God because of grace, a person will live for God because of grace, well, first of all, nobody knows how much, you know, that this is leaves a question mark in your minds. How much will you serve God? Third, how is that not mixing in works? It is mixing in works. You don't add works before salvation, and you don't add it, say, well, people will live for God because of grace. That's backloading works into the gospel, and that won't save you either. Okay, the real grace of God is found in 1 Peter chapter 5. It says in verse 10, But the God of all grace. Now notice we see something about grace. There's no limit to it. All grace. Okay? Who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after that ye have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. By Silvanus, a faithful brother unto you, as I suppose I have written briefly, exhorting and testifying that this is the true grace of God, wherein ye stand. Now, obviously, if there's a true version of it, there's a false version of it. Before I get into the false version of grace, I'd like to explain what the true grace is. Number one, we've already seen that it's something that God has an infinite amount of, all grace. Two, we see that God gets the glory. Verse 11, to him be glory. See, if you're saved by grace, then God gets all the glory. If it's by works or any human merit, then we get the glory. So that's how you know it's that grace is the only thing that saves. The next thing we see about grace is that it comes from God. The true grace of God. God is the source. And then we see that we have a standing in grace that never changes, wherein ye stand. And in Romans 5, we see this again, where it talks about we have a standing in grace because of faith in Christ. And then if you back up to verse 10, it also promises us that we're going to heaven no matter what. Verse 10, it says, But the God of all grace, who hath called us unto his eternal glory by Christ Jesus. So grace has a purpose. Grace makes sure that we get into glory. And this is our position in God's grace. And that's why only free grace people that are actually teaching the correct grace can tell you all about this. And yet the false prophets, they say nothing about it because they don't know anything about it. All they talk about is works and them and human merit. When the Bible describes God's grace as something that we have a standing in and something that we've been called by, and it promises us eternal glory. So that's the good news. That's real grace. So we need to watch out for this false version of grace. And I don't understand why these people have to say anything more when it comes to salvation. For by grace are ye saved through faith. Okay, the Bible says in that not of yourselves. So that basically excludes adding anything to it. Okay, but these people have to do this because they're working for Satan, they're unsaved, they're unlearned, and they're a bunch of fools, and we need to stay away from them, and we don't need, you know, stupid people out there supposedly teaching grace. We need just real people explaining that grace has no merit, no works added to it, you can't add anything to it, and no matter what you do, here's real grace. You get saved, you live like the devil for the rest of your life, you still go to heaven. And that's because of grace. That's real grace. Okay? Anything else is not grace. And yes, grace should encourage us to live for God. But the key word is should. Not will, not must, or anything else. You got to be very careful how you word things. Because the Bible words it a certain way for a reason. Okay? We are his workmanship. We should walk in good works. But we don't have to. And no amount of it's going to prove anything. So watch out for the false grace that doesn't actually save anyone, and it's basically just nothing. It's just like there's nothing there. If you have to have the works, it's been totally expunged. Okay, and the real grace is the grace that never runs out. It keeps abounding where sin abounds, and it saves anybody, no matter what they do, at the moment of faith alone in Christ alone. That's real grace. And they don't have to do anything or prove anything or change anything, and you can't do anything or prove anything or change anything. You just accept the free gift, you know, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Accept the free gift, and then you're saved forever. Nothing changes it. Once saved, always saved. That's true grace. So that's all I have. Dear God, thank you for giving us your clear word. Thank you for allowing us to see what it says on this very important subject. Bless the listeners. I ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.